folks, and welcome back to my top 100 board games of all time. Let's get it started with number 70. It comes from Queen Games, and the game is called High Tide. In this game, you have the unique theme of being a deck chair and trying to move your deck chair up to the beach waterfront. You don't want to get it into the water or the game will end. Now, while you're moving up the beach, the tide is, of course, coming in closer. So eventually, someone's deck chair is going to hit water, and that's going to signal the end of the game. And then whoever has the deck chairs closest to all the different beaches will score points in the game. There's some other additional points you can score as well, but whoever has the most points at the end wins. What a weird theme for a board game, right? Deck chairs on a beach. Now, this game comes with a bunch of little mini expansions they said you could add on. Folks, you need to add them on to have a great game. If you don't, the game's kind of bland and kind of boring. So add in all these little mini expansions. They don't even take anything to learn, and you're going to have a really fun time with this game. If there was ever a party game you could bring to the beach, this would be it. Now, that unique theming and the fact that Amazon dropped this to pennies online one day was the reason I went ahead and bought a copy. I said, why not? Let's see what this is about. I love Queen Games. The theme sounds a little weird, but I'm all for it. Let's see what it is. Super fun. Super great game. Who thought of moving deck chairs up a beach would be an idea for a board game? Good on you, sir. Good on you. Because I do love the game. It's another hit for Queen Games on my list here at number 70. Number 69 is a popular board game which has been around for a while. I just discovered it myself, and so it's on my list here. It's called Biblios. In Biblios, you're basically drafting cards one at a time, and you got to decide what to do with that card. You have three choices. You can lay it out, and so one of the other players can get it, or you can put it on the stack for the second half of the game, which is the auction round, or you can choose to keep that card. The only problem is you have to make the decision right there at that one moment without looking at the rest of the cards to draw. So it's almost like a push your luck. Should I take this one now or should I go even further? I may get something better. It's like a price is right, right? No, I want to go for what's behind door number three. Yay, it's a great card, or, oh, this sucks. I love it. The second half of the game starts once that deck is run out. Then you will start bidding on the other cards in the deck. And what you're trying to do, you're trying to manipulate these big, fat, colored dice that are up on the board to be as high or as low as you want them to go. Higher because you may have a lot of cards in that color. And if you have the most cards in that color, you're going to win that die, which is going to give you points at the end of the game. It is a very uniquely themed game that I just don't see anything else like it. It's very easy to play. Again, I don't really like card games that much, but I do love Biblios. I think it's a fun game, a light fun game that's great to play with groups, definitely worth my time, and that's why it's on the list at number 69. At number 68, I have a strange one. It is eBay, the electronic auction game. Hear me out. This game feels like you're making bids on eBay. I thought this was a cash grab when I first saw it. I said, there's no way that game could be fun. I got a copy. I played it. Oh, wow. One of my favorite bidding games ever, because the electronic device will let you know whose turn is it to bid, and it won't always be equal turns. And so you have to play one of your cards on the three items in the bays that are open for bid, and you're hoping to get the highest bid on that item and maybe win something for low that no one else wants. Because whatever card you had that's the winning bid, that is eliminated from your hand. Any cards you bid that didn't win go back into your hand. So that way it kind of balances out. So if someone's losing a lot of bids on the first half of the game, they're definitely going to come in strong at the end and win just about every auction out there. The game is also set collection as well. The more you have a particular set, the more value it would be. Also, some of the cards that look the same are not the same on the back. You'll flip them over from the estimated value to the actual value, and it could be higher or lower than what you just bid for it. It's a terrible feeling to bid high for a card thinking, that's probably worth $1,500. Nope, it's only worth $8, and I paid $1,200 for it. Oh! But then the exact opposite is true as well. When you bid for something and you got it and you found it was worth more than what it actually was estimated at, yes! Such a simple game. I love bidding on eBay. Does this have that last minute snipe ability? Yeah, because you never know when an auction is going to end. It'll just say, bay one, ended. This is the winner, you know. And then you put a new item in there. Super fun, super easy to play, and my number 68 on this list. At number 67 is Biblios, Dice. It's the dice version of the game Biblios. If you like Biblios and you've never played the dice version, I highly suggest you do. It is much more fun than the regular game. Don't get me wrong, the regular game's fun too, but I enjoyed the dice game just a little bit better. That's why it's up higher on the list here. And in the dice game, you're just rolling all these dice, and of course, you're just picking, you know, whatever die you want to move up certain tracks in the game or to get certain coins or whatnot in the game. It is, there's so many strategies to have, and you have to pay attention to where you are on each track. Sometimes you may not want to get this die, but you have to because you have to move up on this track or else you're going to lose a lot of points, or you could get more points the higher you up on this track. If I get one more here, but look at this one. This one's a much better climb of the ladder, but I'm already first on that one. I need to be up on this one. Lots of decisions to make here. The game goes super fast, too. I think even faster than Biblios. I bought these games as a two-pack from Finn Games, I think. They had them both for sale for like $30 with free shipping. I was like, well, I can't pass that up. And so I got them both, played them back-to-back with my gaming group. We love both the games, but we all decided the Biblios dice was slightly better. So if you like Biblios and you've never tried the dice game, you may want to check it out, because on my list, it ranks higher than the base game at number 67. At number 66 is one of the few vintage games I kept on my board game list here, and it is Can't Stop. Can't Stop is a push-your-luck strategy game where you're rolling these die and trying to roll the same numbers, and you get to decide what numbers they will be each time. Now, every time you roll that particular number, you move one of your three pawns on the board up the ladder. Now, whenever you want to, you can stop. And then that's where you'll save your place for the next turn. But you can't stop. Not for me anyway. I'm always destined to lose this game. I'm like, I can do one more. Push your luck games, I do not do well in, but I do enjoy. Now, I found an old version of this game for like $1 at an antique store, and I could not believe it because I'd heard so much about it, but had never gotten it for my collection. Well, then I got it, played it, love this game. It looks boring. Any version of it looks boring. And if someone's just looking, judging a board game by its cover, they would say, oh, this is not a good board game. But no, folks, there's a lot of gameplay in here, and there is a lot of fun to be had, and Can't Stop. And that's why it's number 66 on this list. Number 65 is a dungeon crawl, I guess I could say that. It's called Mice and Mystics, kind of like a castle crawl, really. But in Mice and Mystics, you are playing as mice, and you're trying to complete these adventures, or maybe the entire quest. And you're basically rolling dice to achieve certain things in the game. And you can play this. They have several expansions. They even have a spin-off game called Tail Feathers, which is vastly different from Mice and Mystics, but yet I still enjoy it. Tail Feathers is like a miniature game using the Mice and Mystics world. And it's just as fun. In fact, I'd probably put both of these as a tie here because I did enjoy Tail Feathers a lot. It surprised me. I'm not a miniature kind of guy, you know, measuring out movement with a ruler or range with a ruler. I'm not that type of guy who loves those type of games, but Tail Feathers is actually pretty good. So both Mice and Mystics and Tail Feathers to me are great games. I do have the expansions for Mice and Mystics. I have played all the way through it. This is another game you can play solo, so I really do like that. I played this game solo. I do want to sit down with my nephews and play this game because I think they would absolutely adore Mice and Mystics. Mice and Mystics has great models. The mice look good. There's centipedes and badgers if you have the expansion. There's tons of other villains, rats and spiders and, oh my goodness, roaches, everything. This game is just really cool to play. It looks cool on the board. I've seen some painted minis that look beautiful. I don't have that talent to paint, but I wish I did, because if I had mine all painted, oh, it'd look even better than it does. But it's a super fun game. The storyline for the quest are just so imaginable. And it's just, I think it's based off a book series. I don't know much about its history, but I do know it's a super fun game and my number 65 on this list. Number 64 is a game called Drumroll. And Drumroll, you are running a circus. And basically, it's kind of worker placement where you're placing your little tokens down, gathering different things, items you need to build the best show on earth. You're traveling to different places and certain areas, like certain performances. So you have to make sure to draft those performers when you can, build them up, have better and bigger shows, and make a lot of money. And of course, whoever can make the most money and get the most points at the end of, I think it's three shows, three circus performances, wins the game. There aren't that many circus themed games out there, and my wife loves the circus. So when I looked out there for a game, I said, surely there's a good circus themed game. I came across Drumroll. Now, I know the designer because he made another game that I really love, and it's going to be later on in this list. And I was like, okay, well, I know that guy, so I'll check out his game. It came in, the box is super colorful, it looks like one of those old school, you know, circus, you know, areas, and it gives you the feel of running a circus and being at the circus. My wife, who doesn't play a lot of the current board games I have, she likes my vintage, you know, older children's games better, but she did enjoy Drumroll because she liked the circus thing, the look of it, the artwork's really good, the gameplay is awesome, and you may want to get the little bonus package that is sold on their website, Artipia Games, I think is the name of the people who make it, because they sell like a little bonus pack for it. They have these little circus tent counters and a few extra cards and with extra performers, which is awesome. The more the merrier. So I really do love this game. In fact, it probably debuted higher if I got it to the table more often. But for right now, it's a great game and my number 64 on this list. Number 63 is a game that's been around for a long time, but I never bought it until the cheap reprint came out, and that was Robo Rally. And Robo Rally, you are programming these robots by selecting a set of cards and then flipping them over one at a time and moving across the board. Now you're trying to get in certain spots on the board where there are flags, and if you get hit all the points, you're the first one to do that, then you're going to win the game. Now it sounds very simple, right? No, because you don't know what the other players are doing. And so when you're flipping, everyone flips over their card at the same time, one, two, three, four, five, and then you do out the movement. So you could have two robots ramming into each other, or one pushing you onto a conveyor belt that moves you further off your way. Or maybe at the end of the round, if there is a robot that is facing you, it can shoot you and put spam into your program. Spam cards are cards that will make you randomly select a card during the programming phase. You don't want that, because maybe when you want to move left, the next card you pick moves you right. And that's the other thing, you may not get all the cards you need either, and you'll just have to make do with what you have to move yourself further along that board. Now, every time I bring this game out, everyone is shocked on how much they love it. I explain it to them. They think this isn't that fun. I'll be honest, I only bought it because I'd heard other people loved it so much. It didn't look fun to me either. But I did get the cheap little version that came out at Target last year. Everyone complains about the quality of those. Yeah, it is some cheap quality, but to be honest, for a, what is it, $20 is what the game cost? What did you expect? I mean, you didn't expect super nice pieces, did you? And the cheapness of the quality doesn't really affect me or impact my decision on loving this game, because I didn't have the old version to begin with. So they go for way too much anyway. So a reprinted cheap version is fine by me. And I do love the game. I hope they come out with expansion boards for this little cheap version. I heard the rules have changed a little bit from the old version. I wouldn't know anything about that because I've only played my copy. But I do know that no matter what group I bring over, if I throw out Robo Rally, everyone loves Robo Rally. Great game. My number 63. My number 62 is a very popular game in the board gaming world, and it is Pandemic. In Pandemic, you're trying to find the cure to all the diseases before humanity is wiped from the face of the earth. Yes, a very happy, upbeat game. I love this game. I love the expansions for the game. I always introduce the game with On the Brink, and then after that, we always play with In the Lab, too. And now I'm starting to throw in State of Emergency mini games within our games as well, because we've gotten really good at this game. I mean, really good. It got to be where it was a 50-50 win or lose, and now it's most of the time we're going to win, because we've just gotten that familiar with the game. Unfortunately, that's what's kind of led to its demise on my list a little bit. It was ranked number 22 last year, so it fell a full 40 spots on the list. Mainly, it's not because we keep winning. That's actually a good thing. We actually like that. But I'm actually upping it up. We're putting more cards in there. Like I said, the State of Emergency cards, the really bad event cards, we're starting to shuffle those in there. Put a lot more Epidemics in there to make the game harder. And I don't mind losing a co-op game. It's just that my board game group doesn't play many co-op games. And that was the problem with Pandemic. It didn't come to the table once this year. Here's another sad fact. Last year, my buddy bought Pandemic Legacy for us all to sit around and play through it. And I agreed. I was super excited to do that. And here we are at the end of 2017. Season 2 is probably out by now, and I haven't even played the first one. So I don't know. I mean, Pandemic, it's not losing my interest. I still absolutely love the game, but just don't get to play it that much anymore. But hey, it's still a great game, and that's why it's number 62 on the list. At number 61 is my gateway game. This is the game that got me back into board games. It's from Twilight Creations, and it is called Zombies. And Zombies, you're a little man with a shotgun, you're rolling a die, and you're trying to kill either 25 zombies or make it to the center of the helipad. Now, this game has 14 expansions and a few mini expansions on top of that. Plus, it has a bunch of spin-off games like Martians, Cthulhu, Medieval, and Humans that you can combine with the base game to play these Uber games or these crossover games together. And I have them all. I absolutely love this game. Like I said, this is the game that got me and my board gaming group into board games. There was a time where we would play this every Friday for an entire year and a half or something. That's all we played was Zombies. Everyone came over, we played Zombies with another spin-off game or another expansion. And we just kept playing Zombies. We used to bring it all together yearly and have a big Zombageddon. We'd combine all of the expansions. Now, we haven't done that in a few years, so that tradition may be dying. And by the way, this game fell a lot on my list. Last year, I still had it in my top 10. I had it at number 9. So that means it dropped 52 spots. Now, why is that? If I just praise this game so much, why did I drop it that high, that low? Well, for basically two reasons, two valid reasons, I think. One is we don't play it every week anymore. Even last year, when I had my board game group over, I was into a bunch of other board games here, but they still loved Zombies. That's all they could think about was zombies. So what we did is they would agree to play one of my newer games, and then the second game would be Zombies. So even last year, we were still playing Zombies every week that we had a board game group together, but I was introducing them to a new game. Well, I stopped doing that in January, and then we were playing nothing but new games. Now, we did play Zombies a couple of times this year, but not nearly as much as we've been playing it in the past, which leads to a lot of its loss in the ranking because it's not a game that I'm playing all the time. And I'm kind of happy about that. Even though I love the game, there are other games out there that I wanted my group to see and enjoy and kind of branch out. Because to be honest, if I hadn't been introduced to some of these games, then I would still be playing Zombies to this day, and I wouldn't care about any other board game out there. There was a time when I was like that too. Thankfully, my gaming group now loves a lot of games. They're actually caught up with all the games I have in my collection, and so now they're like, okay, we can play other games besides Zombies, but we'll still play Zombies every once in a while, and we love the game. So that's why it's number 61 on the list. All right, folks, that's all for now. Hey, come back next time as I talk about my top 60 board games of all time. See you then.